each one of you should have in your possession now one of these Casio calculators. And the reason that I chose this particular calculator is for our applications, it seems to have everything that you would need for taking an exam, research that you'd be doing in your fluid power system. So, but I want to show you some things that I've learned about it, and I'm also going to show you in a few moments the manual that I have sent to you. It's kind of funny when you get when you opened up your calculator, and if you haven't yet, you should open it up. There is a information manual in there, but you have to have really good magnifying glasses and try to it's hard to work your way around that. So what we have done, and we've sent you in a PDF file, I, with permission from Casio, took that and turned it into a manual. It's got 29 pages to it. There's a lot of information in there. But I'm going to refer to some of these things. It's some of the key things that I've learned in using this calculator on how to manipulate around, how to solve the kinds of things that we typically do in our calculations. Now, one of the kind of a odd thing, if you turn your calculator, I'm going to open this up now for a second. I'm going to show you one reason I did what I did. Is in this calculator, believe it or not, in this area right here, there's a great deal of information. The problem is you can't even see it or read it. And so what I have done, if the booklet that I sent out to you in PDF, on page 4, it explains all of this information here. So there's a great deal of information there, but it's almost impossible to read. Now, looking at the calculator, this is the mode function that we're talking about. And sometimes in our calculations, we like to have only a certain number of decimal places. For example, one of the things that we often do is look at pi, and if I try to determine what pi is, well, I can hit the shift button, and then I go right above here, the exponent, and I hit pi, and I find that pi is 3.14159265 4, and that's a whole lot more digits than I need. Typically, we only want to go to 4 places. Well, what I can do is I can set the mode so that it'll only go to 4 places, and the way to do that is, now that I have pi here, I hit the mode button, which is here, and then I hit number 7, and now it's ready to, it's asking me the question, how many digits do you want to go to? And I want to go to 4. And the moment I hit 4, now I have pi at 3.1416, which is the common one that we would use. Now, to cancel that, because I don't want everything necessarily to be that way, I can again hit mode, and then hit the number 9, and it cancels that. So I'm right back into where I was before. Now, one of the big issues that I know is a problem is dealing with fractions. And so on page 8 in your book, in the pamphlet, they discuss how to do fractions. It's actually quite easy. And one of the reasons why on the other presentation I didn't spend a lot of time on fractions is simply because it is so easy to do with this calculator. Now, one thing that we can do with the fractions, we can mix and we can match them, which is kind of interesting. I can take a fraction and multiply it by a decimal and vice versa and come up with the right answer. So let me give you an example. I'm going to take some numbers. I'm going to take 1/2 plus 3/16 plus 9/32. And I want to add those together. The way I do that, first I'm going to clear my calculator. Now, this button up here, the A over BC, is what is our fraction function. Now, if I want to add these together, I was 1, and then I hit this button, the A of BC, 1/2, plus 3/16, plus 9/32 equals, and I wind up with 31/32. Now, what if I wanted to turn that into a decimal? Well, the easiest way for me to do it, well, let's see, there's a couple of different ways. If I multiply that times 1, I still have 31/32. If I find the inverse of it, which is simply, if I go shift and find the inverse, and then shift back again, I now have it as a decimal, the 0.96875. But now what if I wanted to multiply 1/2 by 1/2? Now I know what the answer is, but the fact is, let's try that out. So I'm going to take 1/2 times 1/2, and then equals, and I have 1/4, and that's what I expected to find. Now, what if I wanted to multiply 1/2 by 0.787? Well, let's see what happens. I'm going to have 1/2 times 0.787 equals, and I wind up with a decimal. Whenever we combine a decimal with a fraction, we wind up with a decimal, and I can't convert it back to a fraction. But fractions then become very easy to work with. It's just that whenever we write the fraction, we write them using this button right here. When we use that button, it keeps it as a fraction, and I can multiply it, I can divide it, I can subtract it, I can add it, do all those things, and I'm going to come up with an answer that will be a fraction. If I want to turn it into a decimal for other purposes, the easiest way that I find is to find its reciprocal twice, and then it comes back as a decimal, and then you can work with it from there. Okay, that has to do with fractions, and again, there's more information on that on page 8 to look at, but that's one of the most difficult things sometimes, that you wonder how you're going to work with a fraction, and the fact is this calculator does it very, very well for us. Sometimes you want to multiply, so let's say I want to multiply 3 times 20, okay? Okay, that's 60, but I want to multiply 3 times another number, so let's see, 3 times 50. But I keep multiplying by 3, so what we can do here is if I have 3 and then I hit the times button twice, it becomes a constant. You can see that a little K appeared here in the upper in the bar up here, and so now I have 3 as a constant. And so if I write down 20, I can just have equals and I get 60. I can write 30 equals and I have 90. I can write 100 and equals, and as long as I have that constant there, it'll just keep multiplying by that number. Now, to clear the constant, all we have to do is simply hit the AC button here, and you see the K goes away, and I'm back to zero. So that can be very handy when you're multiplying or adding, whatever the function is going to be. You just hit either the plus button or the times button or the divide button twice, and when you do, it becomes a constant. The K shows up there, and then you can just keep using that number until you hit the clear button, the AC button, which would clear it. Now moving forward, I want to look at the memory function. This can be a very, very helpful thing when we're trying to work with some numbers. I actually have something in memory right now. Let me clear it out, and then I'll explain exactly how I did that too. Memory minus plus, there we go. The memory function allows us to, whatever number is displayed on the screen, it allows us to then store it for later use. For example, let's say I wanted to have the number pi in my memory so that I could be using that to multiply. So if I hit the shift button and then I hit the pi button here, I have the number, but now I want to use that over and over again. What I can do is I can hit the memory plus button here, and now pi is now permanently, well, I say permanently until I delete it, in memory. And so you can see the letter M has showed up here in the screen, and with that letter you know that there's something there in memory. So I can continue on. I can have 62 times 37 equals, and it's all there, but pi is in the background. Now if I want to multiply that by pi, I can hit the time sign and then hit memory, and it brings up the pi, and then I can have my equals. So now I have pi in memory. Whenever I hit this button, that up. Now, what if I want to get rid of that? Well, the easiest way to do that is actually to hit the plus and minus, what this does, it changes the sign of whatever is there. So right now, this is a positive 3.1416. If I hit this button, it becomes a negative 3.1416. And now if I add, it turns out that my memory now is zero. And so I've been able to cancel out that memory. The next function we're going to look at is the percent function. This is a very simple thing to do, and it's something we may have to do kind of often in our systems. Let's, for example, I want to multiply 60 by 20%. In order to do that, I do 60 times, and then by using my shift key, times 20, and then using my shift key, I hit the equal sign, but just above it is the percent, and then I wind up with 12. So that is 12%. So that's just simply how you'd use the percent key. The next thing that we're going to talk about is the trigonometric functions, which there is so much of that we have to do in looking at the rest of the math class. We've seen how important triangles are and how often we have to deal with these angles. There's some really neat things that we have here. I just want to show you. For example, if I want to find the sine of 30 degrees, if I just hit in 30 and then hit the sine button, it tells me that the sine of 30 degrees is 0.5. Now, what if I knew that I had 0.5 and I wanted to find out what the degrees were that would be equivalent to that? Well, by hitting the shift key, we're able to find what is called the arc sine of the number. And what it's going to do is going to let you know how many degrees would have the value of with the sine of 0.5. So again, if I hit the shift key, and now I hit the sine in the dash 1, then you wind up with 30 degrees. The same thing if I wanted to find the tangent of 30 degrees. It's already in the window here, so if I just hit tangent, I wind up with 0.5773. Again, if I wanted to find out what degree would have that tangent, I hit the shift key, I hit the tan to the minus 1, and I wind up with the arctan, which would be 30 degrees. And the same thing you can do with the cosine as well. We know that, for example, 45 degrees has a sine of 0.707. But again, if I'm given the 0.707, I hit the shift key, hit the sine, and I wind up with 45 degrees. So that's just a wonderful function to be able to work with back and forth, and we'll use it so many times in the work that we do. The next thing I want to talk about is the root function. Now, there's a couple things that are kind of quite simple, and that is that, for example, I wanted to find the square of 6. So I'm going to put in 6, and then I just hit the square button, x to the 2, and that tells me that it's 36. Now, what if I want to find the square root of 36? Well, again, that brings us to the shift key. You take the shift key, you hit the square button, and right above it, it has the square root, and it tells you that it's 6. Now, what if you wanted to find the cube of something? Well, there's a couple different ways to do this. And one way is if I have 6, for example, and I want to find the cube of that, I can hit shift, and then right here I have the cube, and that's going to tell me that it's 216. So again, the shift key and these yellow indications above them, above the numbers, gives you a whole lot of new functionality that you may not have realized that you had. Or, let's see again, I want to find the cube of 6. I can take 6. And here I have the x to the y, and that is letting me know that I can take whatever number is in the screen, and if I push this button, whatever power I put in next, it's going to bring me to that power. So I have 6 to the 3 to the third, which is going to be cubing it, equals, and I wind up with 216. So we have two different ways of doing that. Now, a little bit earlier, or actually during our demonstration, you're going to be seeing a formula where we have to bring something to the power of 0.714. Well, again, that's really not difficult to do with this. You have whatever the number is, let's say it's 456, and I want to bring it to the power of 0.714. I hit my X to the Y, and then I hit 0.714, and it calculates it out for me at 79. So when you're using this calculator, finding the exponents or finding the roots of things, it becomes very, very easy because it's all right there at your fingertips. So as you can see, this is a very, very handy small device. It does all the things that really you need to do when you're working, certainly for taking the exam, and it covers all those areas. But again, take note of the information that we sent along with it, because that's going to be very, very helpful as well.